right, guys, and our athlete role models are here with us. Everyone up on your feet, here we go. This is Sergey Pupka
and Alexander Popov. All right, once again, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome down to Chat with Champions. Tonight, together with our two athlete role models, we have with us Sergey Bubka
and Alexander Popov.
Now, we are also live to the rest of the world on our webcast. So, guys, do you want to wave to the camera? Everyone here, wave to the camera. Okay. Now, we're going to do a little introduction of our two athletes over here.
Yes, we're going to start with Alexander Popov right here, and let's look at his slides. He is a four-time Olympian with 9 medals, and he got gold in 50-meter and 100-meter freestyle at consecutive Olympic Games. He also broke the 50-meter freestyle world record in the year 2000. He is also 11-time medalist for World Championships, and for the European Championships, a whopping 26-time medalist. And let's go on to watch a video of Alex's moment in the Olympics. And that's him for the 50-meter freestyle man in Atlanta in 1996, when he got the gold medal. And a standing time of 22.13 seconds, and that's Alexander Popov. They love you.
And a lot they of girls over you. Here screaming for you. Okay, and we also have with us, right beside me, Mr. Sergey Bubka. Now, he is a four-time Olympian. He won gold at the 1988 Olympic Games. He set the pole vault record at the age of 21, and he went on to rewrite his record 35 times. Now, Mr. Sergey Bubka also... he still holds the record for the outdoor games set in 1994, a height of 6.14 meters. That is, I think, really, really high, right, sir? Very, very. Over 2 stories high. And he is also a 6-time gold medalist for the World Championships. Let's check out his Olympic moment. Now, this is Sergey Bubka's moment at the Seoul Games 1988. This is when he won the gold medal with that height. And that was when he became the gold medalist for the Youth Olympic Games.
And he did this 35 times, setting records over and over again.
That's right, and he's here right now with us, Sergey Bubka.
Okay, I know you guys are excited. You have questions as well to ask our two Olympians right here. But we have a first question first, right? Okay, we're going to ask Alex first. So how did you discover your talent as a swimmer? How do you know you were good at swimming? And the man considers...
You know, I was not only good at swimming, I was also good at weightlifting, judo.
And how old were you then?
How old? About 22.
That's my age.
No, to be serious, any kid is talented at, you know, at something. It's up to the parents or teachers at school, you know, to maybe give a guidance to, in particular, the parents of the child to suggest where to sort of put your child, what kind of activities he is good at. And I was put in swimming, in a swimming pool. And, well, I don't regret it.
Okay, Alex, great. We just want to tell you one thing. There are a lot of swimmers here today for you. Swimmers, make some noise for Alex.
Raise your hand and say hi.
All the swimmers over here. And Sergey, don't worry. We also have the guys from athletics. They are all pole vaulters over this side. Make some noise, guys.
Pole vaulters.
All right. Well, a bit, you know, guys, a bit louder. You have Bubka here, not... anybody but Bubka, you know, Bubka. Oh, You weren't even born when he won the Olympic Games.
Okay, so Sergey, same question for you. How did you discover your love for pole vaulting? Because pole vaulting is not as a popular sport as like the rest of it, like swimming, for example. So how did you discover your love and talent for pole vaulting?
Now, first of all, I never saw pole vault before I start my career because I play different sports with my friends at school and also on the street where we lived. And my older friend, who was 3 years older, he said to his coach when he started to do pole vault that he has small boy, 10 years old, it's very good. And the coach said it's for pole vault in age 10, it's too early, bring him 2 years later. But he was real friend and he convinced the coach, no, this is really good boy, I would like to bring him. And coach agreed and I came to first training, I did 30 meters quite fast and I did 15 times pull-ups and I started to be pole vaulter. But it was so nice, so exciting, and we played different sport, not only pole vault. In this case, I never thought to change and go to football or maybe to some other sport. This is, I would say, destiny.
Destiny, and indeed, a big round of applause for Mr. Sergey. Now, just continue on, Mr. Sergey. Now, we have all the young athletes here, their age between 14 to 18 years old. You set the world record at age 21, and you went on to rewrite your own record 35 times, guys. Big round of applause, 35 times, rewrote his world record. What would you say to all the young athletes here who aspire to be a record holder like yourself?
I would like to confirm what is Alexander said, that every one of you has talents. It's for sure. Otherwise, you will not be today in first Youth Olympic Games. The question how you will use your talent, how you continue to improve your performance. This is most and important things for you. To try to be better every day. Never give up. Work hard. And you will be on the Olympic podium. You will be the best in your sport. This is clear. Everything depends on you. And the second thing I would like to also recommend you, listen to your coach. Follow his advice. Because his coach gives you all the knowledge to be the best. And for sure, you will be the best.
And that's Sergey. So Alex, we have a question for you. Like what Bupka said, you have to keep improving and improving medal after medal, game after game. And for you, you won gold at two Olympic games. So in between these two Olympic games, what was the pressure like for you?
Well, there was no pressure, there was responsibility. And that is probably the hardest part that you can imagine. Responsibility of not swimming badly. Being maybe a role model already then for the swimmers in the field and trying to improve yourself from race to race. So these are the tasks that I was facing and I was actually trying to fulfill.
And you came out of really good. You won gold medals at both Olympic Games.
Pretty average, yeah. Pretty average.
Pretty average.
Pretty average. two gold medals. A big round of applause for Alex as well. All right, now they've been sharing valuable advisors as well as their experiences. And I'm sure all the young athletes here, you have questions that you want to ask them as well. So we're going to open the questions up to the floor right now. Marcus, what do they have to do if they have a question?
Yeah, very easily. If you have a question, raise your hand and one of our friends will bring you the microphone. When you get the microphone, tell us your name, tell us your NOC, and also tell us what sport you are playing.
Okay, so here we go. If you have a question, just raise your hand.
And by the time you know somebody, yeah, well, there is one hand there. But by the time the mic gets to you, I'll tell you a little story. You know, why I ended up in swimming. I live, in the country of Russian Federation, which is quite big, and, you know, sometimes it can get cold. Why I didn't play any other sports, for example, tennis, you know, by the time you hit the ball and it gets to another side, it freezes up.
So I have a question. Then how does the pool not freeze up?
It's indoor.
Oh, I think I have another theory. When you go in the pool...
And it's got in-slab heating, and you know, we also, the coach had to keep the pot, you know, to boil the water, and pour it in the swimming pool.
All the time, you know? All the time. Yes, yes. I totally understand that.
Okay, Alex, would you like this theory instead? Like, because when it's an outdoor pool and you go in, you're so hot, you melt the water.
That's it too.
All the girls are
I think they agree with you.
Okay, so girls, if you have a question for Mr. Sergey or Mr. Alex, do we have it? We're going to take a question from the floor right now.
Yeah, not just girls, boys as well.
There's a question there.
And the gentleman in red
all
over there.
All the way at the back.
Hey, Alex, my name's Eric. I'm from the United States and I'm a swimmer. And I was just wondering, when did you think that you would have the chance to make the Olympic team? And when you got that, did you change your training at all? Or did you change your mentality of the sport? Or I was just wondering that.
Well, thanks, Eric, for that question. Apparently, a big inspirer of mine back in 1991 in November was Mark Spitz. That was an Olympic season already then. It was my birthday, apparently, and he said his birthday wish for me was, I would wish for you to be an Olympic champion at 20, not at 24. And then when we got back, you know, that was after New Year's, just a little bit after New Year's, we started to train, and then I started to realize, you know, what he said is actually, it was honest, first of all, and that was coming from the heart, this birthday wish. And then you sort of start to concentrate and think, okay, I only have one opportunity here, and I would like to use it. Not would like, I must use it. And that word must drives you forward. I didn't want to say otherwise, but drives you forward. And you don't change your training pattern or training schedule, you only change yourself. Your dedication, you drop everything out from, you know, your career, anything but training and competing and achieving the result. Everything else comes afterwards quite easily, you know, it's all there. It will never go anywhere. It is there even now. But the most important factor for me was that birthday wish of Mark Spitz. Pretty interesting, huh? Thanks, Eric. Anyway, it's an interesting question.
All right. Thank you, Alex. And, well, if you have another question, raise your hand. And when you ask the question, do stand up so that everyone can see who you are. All right? Now, any more questions for either Alex here or Sergey?
Well, guys, we're not going to buy it back anyway.
Okay. There is a girl from Cedar over there.
It's got to be pole vaulting. Pole vaulters. They're sitting on two sides. Swimmers are more here in the center.
Shasha from Singapore. I swim. Yeah, okay. What do you say to yourself when you're on the diving board about to swim the race? How do you motivate yourself?
Is it for me or for Sergey?
For
swimmers. How do you motivate yourself? You know, it's, the day before the race, it's too late to motivate yourself. You have to be motivated when you qualify for the national team, for the national Olympic team, I must say. And this is when you really have the responsibility of not performing poorly. You know, not everybody comes to win, but everybody comes to improve their time and do their personal best. So this is what you're aiming for, your personal best. It can be a gold medal, it can be place number 9, or it can be place number 50. But anyway, what you do, you try to concentrate on your own race, your own performance. As soon as you start looking around and see how your opponents are swimming, what they do, how fast they swim, you lose straight away. 5-10 meters, and you're gone. You're at the end of the tribe. So do your own thing. That's the most important thing.
Okay, and we'd just like to ask thank you, Alex. We'd just like to ask Sergey as well, how do you prepare yourself for your competition?
You mean before, days before competition?
Oh, why not just before you jump? What goes through your head?
No, but I think it's every athlete's always facing the stress and facing certain difficulties. The main point, how you put your thoughts before the competition, what you're thinking, if you support yourself positive way, if you send the message that you can manage, I believe I can win. This is very important messages, because otherwise, if you put concern or someone give you pressure and you start to afraid, oh, I will not do it. I'm not in good shape. Never think negative. Believe in your success. Focus to your technical skills or important part of your competition, which should be done perfectly well. In this case, you can be successful. And what is Alex said, I just want to say, I had also the motto, beat yourself, you can beat everyone. The first victory against yourself.
Very inspirational quotes from Sergey and Alex. Now, any more questions?
We have one. Okay. We'll take this from the back first.
Yeah.
The lady in red.
Lady in red.
Lady in red. Yes.
Good evening. My name is Kwanis John, and I'm the young ambassador for Trinidad and Tobago. Injury is something that happens all the time in sport. I want to know, have you all ever been seriously injured and had to come back from injury and perform at the Olympics, or even have it ever hindered your performances, and what was the mental preparation come back to your best?
So you're talking about them getting injured and how they recover and come back again. So, Alex?
Well, I had an injury back in 96, and apparently swimming helped me to recover. I don't know how you motivate yourself, how you get back into it, you know, but that was the only way for me to recover fully, is to get back into the training process, and get back to the, not the job, but to the, I don't know, to the activity that I really liked and loved. And did I come back to my best results? Well, I managed to set a couple of world records after that. I finished second in the Olympic Games. I won two world championships after that, a couple of European championships. So I would say you can do it. You can do it. You know where the problem lies and where your strengths are, or strength is? Between the ears.
I didn't hear you.
You know where your strength is?
Mm-hmm.
Between the ears. Between the ears is here.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
in your head.
Yeah.
It's how you approach it mentally and psychologically. Okay. If you can do it, if you believe in yourself, you can do it.
And you, Mr. Sergey Bubka?
Well, it's my biggest and serious injury. It's happened in 1996 before Atlanta Games. I got small injury in April. It was small tear of Achilles tendon, but I discovered this later. And of course, we didn't thought it was something serious. We tried to postpone two weeks and come back again. And I even competed with the pain through 3 months. But when I arrived to Atlanta, and also was mistake of the doctors, then they mentioned, because we thought that something is wrong. And we went to check. They said, it's nothing serious. You can compete with the pain. Don't be afraid. It was just 2 weeks before Olympic Games in Atlanta. When I came, I did fantastic training. I was in one of my best shape. I think that season I could jump maybe that time 6 meters, 30 centimeters, much higher than my personal record that time. But I couldn't walk after the last pole vault training, because 10 days getting more and more pain. When I came to qualification, it's 10 days become double. I was not able to run anymore. And I not consider that I give up, but I went out from the competition because I was not able to compete. Couple months later, I tried to avoid the surgery, because any surgery, it's always risk. It's no one doctor in the world give you guarantee that you will come back for 100%. And of course, I tried to avoid, but in the end, a couple months later, I did surgery, because when I checked next morning the tendon in the clinic in Olympic Village, it was 25% cut of the tendon. And the doctor said, if you push yourself to run, it will be complete crash. It was good that you stop. And in December, I did surgery. And 8 months later, I won my sixth world championship. because in athletics there's still no one won the 6 consecutive world championships. I won 83, 87, 91, 93, 95, and it was 97. That victory was most valuable and most difficult for me, because 3 months you didn't train anything. And after 3 months, you start to make first jogging. It means you didn't have normal training preparation. I would tell you that it was very difficult to recover. One day you feel good, but next day you couldn't walk because your tendon is sore and it's inflamed again. Even doctor said 6 months later after the surgery, this pain is not any more dangerous, but it's still in your brain and you still feel it. But when you feel it, your movement is not the same. But the most problem, you was not able to train well. It was impossible because it's not allowed. Your tendon didn't allow it. And in the end, for me, it was a very difficult decision to go to championship or not, because my performance before the world championships was 5 meters 61 centimeters. It was very, very poor result. And I got also motivation because my opponents started to criticize me and to say in the press that Sergey is not a brave guy, he was not able to finish sport career, he doesn't want to retire, why he is going to world championships. And this is for me was the best motivation, to try to prove that I'm alive. I was not ready for victory that championships. I was not in good shape because my injury didn't allow me to prepare. But I want to win because I don't want to be a loser. And the second, it was great motivation. But in the end of the competition, and I clear 6.01 centimeters, 5 centimeters more than my opponent. And it's really, I would say, that championship, it was mission impossible. But I achieved, and I would say, I proved that I alive. This was so important for me, to my opponents, to show that I am not dead. I am still competing, and I was very happy for that victory.
And so sometimes competition really helps to motivate our athletes. So, any more questions? And we had a question there.
Hi, my name is Jeff Lum, and I'm from Hong Kong, and I play swimming, 50 meter freestyle, same as you. So I have 2 questions to ask you. The first is, I want to ask you why every time you go up to the block and then your reaction time starts very slow. Why? What's your technique you use? And the second question is, when Australia swimmer Eamon Solomon breaks your record, how do you feel? Did you shocked or what? Yeah, thank you.
So you were saying that his reaction time was short, and why? Slow.
Sergey, question to you.
Okay, Sergey, question for you. If you still hold the world pole vault record, what if one day someone, one of the pole vault there guys, they beat your world record? What would you say to anyone who beats your record one day?
$10,000.
I don't have any problems right now because I retired 10 years ago in Sydney. It's not anything, it's belonged to me. And I believe in one day for sure the young talent will jump higher. This is why we are here and we are sharing with you, to help you to build your successful future. I will feel very well. And of course, when I competed, and it's happened sometime, that my opponents break my record, sure, I was not happy. But I start to work next morning is even more hard because I want to get new record back to me. This is, I think, it's fantastic motivation.
And that motivation won him 35 times. Okay.
Very right. Motivated. Huh? But going back to your question, first of all, we set the records, you know, to be broken in the future. And when I set the record, I set the record using only traditional swimsuit.
With suit or without suit, Sasha?
With the pole or with pole. And it was technological breakthrough, I would say, you know. But now the guys are swimming, certainly swim faster. But why I was slow, I didn't want to do the false start. As you know, in swimming we have no false start rule. And I was disqualified twice in my career. Once I've lost the World Cup overall trophy in, I believe that was 95 or 95, I think. I've lost it in Germany, was disqualified on the 50 meters. And second time, I think I was disqualified in Cannes during that Mare Nostrum tournament. I've learned my lessons. So thank you very much. But now you have guys new starting blocks, which allows you to be even quicker off the blocks, but not much, 0.1 of a second. I could manage to get it under the water, to gain it back and even more. So that's pretty interesting. Back then it was different story. Yeah? I was competing, few years ago, and now it's certainly different stuff, different guys, different motivation, different everything. All right. Thank you.
No, I just want to add, if I understood your question well, that Alex started very slow, but he finished very fast and he finished first. I think it's most important who is finish and cross the line first. And he did very well.
Well, also, we quite commonly use, in the Russian language, we use an expression. The bad horse starts from the start, begins to run from the start, and it doesn't make it to the end. A good horse starts a bit slower and builds it up.
I believe it sounds better in Russian.
Okay, why don't you say the phrase in Russian?
What is that?
The phrase in Russian.
We have "плохая лошадь со старта берет."
That was the direct translation in Russian.
Yeah, it sounds better.
Okay, we're going to take the next question from this gentleman in front over here.
Right in front.
Hello, Avi Bracha, coach, triathlon coach from Israel. Two questions for both of you. Who was your model or hero when you're an athlete or a swimmer? And secondly, when you spoke about listen to your coach, what do you mean? No, it's not a joke, it's real.
Alex?
Age before beauty.
No, Sasha, please go.
Yeah. Okay, whatever.
I shy so much.
What was the question?
No, I can.
You again. See, the thing is, yeah, no. I
don't take him serious. Be careful.
No, it's cynic.
I don't know whether I could say I had idols or role models before my eyes, but I've certainly learned from many swimmers. I've learned from Mark Spitz. I've learned from Matt Biondi, great American swimmers, sprinters, and very inspiring personalities. But what I was trying to do, I was trying to create my own way. My own way of, behavior, approaching, racing, and even I'll try to answer the second question straight away. Even the relationship with the coach, I was trying to build it up to make it not just a coach and athlete relationship, but more of a friend. And I think we've succeeded pretty well. We're still friends after 20 years now, and we're still good friends, which is very important.
Well, I never have a role model in pole vault because my coach teach me technique and everything. It was in certain way, it's new. And we didn't see that complete athletes who is really belong to that technique and performing in this way. But I have a hero in athletics, it's Viktor Saneev. It was three-time Olympic champion in triple jump, 68, 72, 76. And in Moscow Olympic Games, in fourth games, he was silver medalist. and he was also world record holder for some time. He was a great athlete and fantastic personality. It's really great human being, respect the people, and I admire his achievement, and he was my role model, and I try to be like him. Regarding the coach, in my case, when I start athletics in age of 10, my coach, he dreamed to take the boy from beginning, because that time the girls didn't jump. Pole vault only that time belonged to the men. And he took me from age of 10 and he brought to the top. We won with him everything. Olympic championship, world championships, many records. He dreamed to do this success and we went together. For me, he was my father. It's like second father. I trust him, I listen him. He always teach me to do sport and do study because I go that time to normal school. It means sometime before training, I did training myself. 8 o'clock I'm in school and afternoon I go to sports school to practice. And he always guide me in my life. And we are, since 1974, we have excellent relation. And he's still coaching, he's still devote himself to sport. And of course, the coach give you everything. Because when you come in as kid, you don't know anything. And it's your role, it's very important. I would say it was great step also done here in Youth Olympic Games, if you realize it was first time in Olympic history that oath was done by coach. Usually it's athletes, referee, and here it's also the coach. Because also this is recognition of the role of the coaches and it's big responsibility. For me, coach responsible not only in the sport of field, also outside of field of competition. Because the kid trusts you and follow you. And you spend more time than parents, and they listen to you. In this case, what you're teaching outside, if they can combine sport and education same time. For me, yes. And this is important, and you need to go through this education and successful sports career. It's your job, I mean, as coach job, it's great job. For me, the coach, I put from big letter. This is great teacher.
And that's for all the coaches out there.
Do we have another question from the floor? Okay, we have a question over there. Okay, while the mic is being passed, Alex, I'd just like to ask you a question. Alex, from where Sergey left off about education, all the athletes we have here are young athletes. So can you tell them, advise them, how did you manage to juggle education and sport for yourself?
How did we manage it? We just did it.
Just do it.
That was our responsibility. One of our responsibilities is actually to go to school and learn subjects and so on and so forth, you know, get a good education. And then on other hand, we had another responsibility, which is sports achievements and sports result. We had Soviet system, which was investing a lot of money into sport, into young athletes, into social activities, let's say, of its population, of its nation. And we had two responsibilities: education, which is a compulsory in Russia, and sport, which is also a compulsory to a certain extent. And already I think I mentioned, or if not, it, at the end of the day, it comes to maybe a couple of things that maybe we would like to emphasize on is self-discipline and self-management. If you can develop these two qualities of yourself, you can do education, you can do good sport, good sporting career, you can achieve high results, and you will be very good educated at the same time. It's not easy, you just have to try.
Another question from the audience members.
Okay, right in front over here.
Black, yeah.
Hi, my name is Anita. I come from South Africa and I'm also a swimmer. My question is directed to both of you. what was the best piece of advice that you were given throughout your career that you would never forget? And what advice would you give to young, inspiring athletes? And my other question is, what would you say characterizes a successful athlete? What characteristics would you say define a successful athlete?
Sergey first.
Okay.
Sergey, it is two questions. The first question is the best advice you've ever received for yourself that you would like to share with everyone here, as well as the second question.
The second question was?
What characteristics define a successful athlete?
Yes.
No, I think I would like to say never give up. This is most important, because each of us, in certain period of our career, we face some difficulties, we face some problem. And I remember I tried to improve my results, but I didn't succeed. It's 1 year I didn't succeed. And in this moment, you start to think, oh, I am able or not. My best advice, continue to work hard. Listen to the coach, analyze everything what you are doing, and you will improve results. Believe in yourself and you will be successful. Characteristic, strong character, self-discipline, as Sasha said. You need to work very hard. You need to dream and go to the goal. And always try to improve yourself. Never satisfied with your performance. Today, you are the champion. Today you can celebrate. You deserve, you enjoy it. But next morning, start from scratch. Forget that you're Olympic champion, or you're world champion, or world record holder. Start to work again to improve and to be better. In this case, you will be the best.
I might just say, I might add a few little bits and pieces here and there, but mainly what Sergey said is absolutely correct. What I could probably add is enjoy. Enjoy what you're doing. Always smile, not foolish smile, you know, like, but smile as a pleasure, you know. And for example, if you have, let's say, a tough competition, a final of national championships or Olympic Games or qualifications for Olympic Games, the smile will help you to win. When you enjoy yourself, the way you swim, the way you perform, the way you, the easiness that you are achieving the results with, you will start smiling. You'll be positive, you know, and people will be respecting you for that. And you always have to respect your opponents and respect everything that you do. That would be, you know, in addition to what Sergey already said. Self-discipline, self-management, so on and so forth. Trust in the coach, believe in yourself, you know, listen in your parents, remembering that all, they are always behind you. And you will definitely succeed.
Very valuable advice. Thank you for the question. We would like to open the floor to over there, the Japanese athlete. Oh, okay, over here. You in the black.
Well, we have a few more hands rising, so it's good. Good to see.
My name is Taryn McKenzie. I'm a swimmer as well from South Africa. It's a really simple question, but I've always wondered about it. I know a lot of my friends say, when I'm finished with my swimming career, I never want to see another swimming pool. I'm not even going to have one in my garden, and so on and so forth. And I was just wondering, you can both answer, do you still carry on to this day? Do you go to the pool, and obviously not hard training like you used to do, but do you still swim up and down and enjoy it and have fun? Well, you can both answer.
Well, Sergey actually never went to the swimming pool.
No, but like
after
for his
second training. But what about Sergey? Do you still practice pole vaulting?
No, pole vault I never practiced since that time when I retired. When I retired in 2000, and I never do pole vault. I want to remember my best vault because it's a very demanding event. You need to be in good shape to perform even for yourself. But I'm surviving with all my activities because of sport. I can do running, I do biking, I go to gym, I go to pool, and I really enjoy sport and discover many new sports which I never did before, and even the swimming. A couple years ago, we came with Alexander to Athletes Commission meeting in Lausanne, and I said to Alex in the evening when we arrived, Alex, let's go to swim, let's enjoy. And he said to me, listen, it's too much for me swimming. But this morning he did already swimming. I was really impressed that he swam this morning.
Well, just to continue Sergei's conversation. Well, I rarely go to the swimming pool now. Very rarely, maybe every 3 months or so I can throw myself in the water or make such an effort. Not because I'm tired of water, because I just don't want to do it for now. I want to concentrate on something different. I really like, different type of activities like four-wheel driving, when you go like really crazy. Camping, stuff like that. Yeah. Go to the countryside. It's a different activity, but it's still demanding and it's very tiring. Swimming in the mud, certainly. But no swimming, not now.
Okay.
Let's be honest, huh?
Alex and Sergei, I'd just like to add on to a question. I think your question is also post-career. What happens after your competition career ends? Is that right? Okay. So Sergei, what did you do after your sporting career ended? What was your post-career plans from then to now? What were you doing?
You mean what I'm doing now, yes? Now, we were elected with Alexander in 1996 by athletes in Atlanta Olympic Games to IOC Athletes Commission. And since that time, we involved with Alexander in IOC activities, and we become IOC members. It's first active athletes who become IOC member. When I retired in 2001, I was elected to Council of International Association of Athletic Federation, and now I'm Senior Vice President of Athletic Federation. I'm President of National Olympic Committee. It means I'm full-time dedicate all my activities for sport, because I got from sport everything what I have today, and I have great pleasure and honor give something back to sport. I'm really enjoy it, work for sport.
And just to echo what Sergei said, I do some sports administration back in Russia, so I, as well as Sergei, give sport back to what it gave me. Some skills, maybe some fresher knowledge.
All right, any more questions from the floor?
My name is Maya, Japan swimming.
Don't be nervous.
スプリンターなのに練習オリンピック前に練習はいっぱいしてましたか?
We'll wait for the translation.
Hold on, let me get on this.
This question is directed for Alexander. He's saying that, do you practice really very hard even if you are competing for a short distance race like 50 meters or 100 meters?
I don't think so.
Well, let me tell you a little bit prelude, before I answer your question. We consider sport being divided into a few groups. So swimming is a cycle sport. You have to do the same movements over and over again. So we have cross country or Nordic skiing, we have biathlon, we have swimming, we have cycling. So a good friend of mine in Russia, he was working at the professional basketball club. He was the president of the professional basketball club. And then he joined the biathlon team. And he said, when I saw biathletes train, then I realized that everything else is a fitness. So I would say athletics is probably fitness compared to what swimmers do. And yes, we did a lot of mileage. That is absolutely true. You know, my maximum mileage a day was 20 kilometers or 15, 16 miles or something like that. And why we did it? Well, because I wanted to swim fast and I wanted to swim long in terms of duration. And not long because of the distance, but because of the duration of my career. And this is what I wanted to do. And to maybe go back to your question, when you introduced yourself, you said, how old are you, 17? Yeah. You. 18. At the age of 18, I didn't even swim 50. I swam 200 backstroke, I swam 200 medley. The next step for you would be 25. So you need to concentrate more on 100, and 50 comes automatically, okay? If you swim only 50 at the age of 18, you tend to swim shorter distances when you get older. So get back in training, do your 20 kilometers a day, 100 kilometers a week, and you'll be fine.
20 kilometers? Sergey was going, what?
No, but it seems 20 kilometers for me. I need to practice day and night to pass and swim in 20 kilometers.
Well, have you ever seen us swimming?
You?
Yeah.
Yeah, in the pool, yes, of course.
Yeah, but not this morning, but when we were training.
I know you train minimum 3 times per day.
No, that's why you didn't see us, because we swam so fast, you didn't even realize that was us.
Oh, okay.
Speaking up for the swimmers. Okay, one more question from the floor. Anyone? Okay, we have a lady right in the middle over there. She has a question.
Yeah, just one last question.
Okay, while the mic is being passed to her, Alex, just a fun question for everyone here. You know, when you guys win the gold medal, you get a lot of attention from the media, you get a lot of attention from the girls everywhere. How do you handle that kind of attention, Alex?
Sergey first, please. Age before beauty, this time.
So, Sergey, how do you feel when everybody is cheering for you, the media asking you questions? What is going through your mind?
Well, in the beginning, because we grew in Soviet system, we didn't have so much press. And of course, we were educated a little bit different. I was really restricted to speak too much with press. I always focused for competition. I didn't lose concentration, especially when you're getting close to competition, it's better to avoid talk too much. Because this is also the energy. You need to be focused. And of course, it's when the Soviet Union collapsed, it's everything is changed. You go to competition and you have press conference before, you need to have press conference afterwards. All such things you need to learn, you need to handle, because this is normal for athlete in good level to communicate with the media, because it's also nowadays is important, because you have sponsors. Sponsors want to see you when you are speaking and nicely speaking, not just to say a few words. This is important part. And regarding the crowd and spectators, for me, when I competed, it's always great motivation. After a certain period of my success, I was not interested to compete for myself, because I proved for myself I can achieve something. And when I go to the stadium, when I competed and I see the full stadium, this is motivation. I am competed for the crowd. But when the stadium is empty, I'm not interested. One record more or one victory more. This is a certain relation which I developed through career. It was different in the beginning, but later on, I tried to perform for my fans.
And I'm sure the crowd here loves you as well. Sergey Bubka, everyone.
Alex Popov.
Sergey, when I'm listening to you, you know, I forget all questions and I'm just enjoying.
No, but you always put me first, and after you just listen.
Okay, Alex, we're going to take the question from the floor. So, question?
Hi, I'm Yvette, also a swimmer from Hong Kong. And I got a question about passion. Do you ever feel dull training day in and day out? And what have you gained from sport? Like, what have you gained most from sport? Also, my friend beside me got a very interesting question. Maybe you would like to say it.
So I'm Fancy, and I'm from Hong Kong too, and I'm a triathlete. And we're both role models. Feel lonely sometimes when you achieve certain levels of achievements, and how will you face it or overcome that? Thank you.
Well, yeah, to start with, what was the question?
Okay, would you like to repeat
both questions? No, I remember the questions. You see, the thing is that maybe to start from the second part of the question. Well, it's like I don't know any other ways but, you know, enjoying the competitions, enjoying the results. And actually that would be the most probably most valuable aspect of your motivational side of everything else of your life, you know, achieving the result. Is the motivation itself. The other way is how you treat it. So, for example, as Sergey said, you know, I fully agree with him here. As soon as you win a competition, you go through a normal procedure, press conference, drug testing, medal ceremony. As soon as you step outside of that venue, you forget about this and you think of tomorrow. What's coming tomorrow? Okay, and that would be the simple way of explaining things because, you know, there is another day, more races come, especially in swimming, as you know. And going back to question number one. Going back to the question number one, I would say is that you know, sometimes you girls put us in the corner, you know, like, there's no way out. And so sometimes, you know, it's how you find such an explanation for this thing.
Why not we get Sergey to answer that question then?
Yeah, probably. If Sergey can help me.
I might
think a little bit. You know, I'm a bit slow, even though I'm a sprinter.
Because,
you know, by the time the question gets to me, you know, takes a while.
Yeah, she was saying, you know, day in, day out, sport can get quite dull. So how do you get motivated and...
No, I think you have the goal. It will be not always every training is it's very good or easy. But you have some important competition in this season. I don't know when you start the preparation, 3 months before, 5 months or 6 months before. In this case, you need to go to this goal. And you will enjoy most, of course, you can have fun, you can enjoy the training. But the most enjoyable time, when you're standing on the podium, when the anthem is playing of your country, and you feel proud, your parents proud, your country proud about your success, I think this is a great moment to remember why you're working hard. Because to be on the top, you need to overcome some difficulties. In this case, you find the motivation not to do mistake, not repeat the same mistake. Try to do always better and better. Climbing, it's not always fun. Sometimes it's tough, but you know why you go this way. To be the best, to feel the champion, to see the flag. I think this is great, great motivation. Remember that.
Very, very valuable advice. Final one, both Sergey and Alex. All these athletes in front of us right now, they are young athletes competing in the Youth Olympic Games. Maybe in London 2012 or other Olympics, they will be Olympic champions. So what advice or message, very quickly, would you like to say to all of them and the rest of the world watching this? Alex or Sergey?
It's my brother's start. Alex.
Beauty before the age now. So what piece of advice, huh? Guys, really enjoy what you're doing. Really enjoy it, and not even every moment, every moment of a second. Enjoy it because it never comes back. It can only get harder and tougher from here. So the thing is that for you, I really would like to, once in your lifetime, you must have experience of Olympic Games. Because not everybody on the planet, it's only 10,500 athletes who have this privilege of competing at Olympic Games out of 6.5 or so billion people. So you are already special. You don't need to prove it to anyone, you don't need to prove it to yourself. The only result can prove it is the medal. So do your best, get out there, and don't leave any chances to your opponents.
A very meaningful, and thank you so much for joining us today, sharing your experiences and advices.
But Sergey is a bit quiet. We need to listen
Sergey,
to my elder
Sergey
brother.
Sergey would like to
brother.
Say something as well.
Thank you very much, Sasha. You are a real friend. No, but this is Olympic solidarity, you see. He gave me floor, and I would like to say you, it's really great for you because you are in first Youth Olympic Games. This is you are doing the history. I believe you will be back home and you will spread the message what you learn here, what you see here. Because you develop the friendship. You see the your friends, your colleagues, they're same. Doesn't matter where they're living. And you will be great ambassador of Olympic movement in future. And of course, personally, I would like to see you on the big Olympic podium. Because you have talent for that. And I think you have now, after these games, great, great motivation to be the best. And we believe you will be the best in your future of sport. Good luck.
And ladies and gentlemen, that is Sergey Bubka and Alexander Popov. Unfortunately, we don't have any more time for any questions. This marks the end of Chat with Champions.
But once again, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, a big round of applause. Show some love for Sergey Bubka as well as Alexander Popov. Okay, and for those of you who want to have a chat with our athlete role models or take a picture with them, you can do so outside. They will be outside and they will entertain you. They'll take a picture with you. So this, once again, ladies and gentlemen, Alexander Popov and Sergey Bubka.